So hi everyone, welcome to the lecture 1 of module 6, that is ArcGIS ZA202 structural analysis 1. Okay. So the beams transfer the applied load into the end support by bending and shear action. For larger spans, beams are very uneconomical, and many times the self weight of beam contributes to the stress in such large proportions that it is difficult to design beams for larger spans. So when the beams are uneconomical, we are going to design the arches. So for larger spans like bridges, the arches are provided instead of beams. So the arches are curved beams, usually in vertical plane, and that transfer the loads to their plane. It is just inverse of the cables that is we discussed in the last module. Okay, so unlike cables, arches carries compression. That is, this time you just recall the cables. In the cables, that mainly carries the tensile forces or the tension. In this, the arches carries compression. And the cables, they are flexible in order to adjust with the loads that has comes upon these cables. And the arches are not flexible, and they are rigid structures. Okay. Now, arches transfer loads to abutments at springing points. So these are the springing points which is shown in this figure. Okay. The hinges may be provided at this springing points. Okay. The highest point of the arch is called crown. This is the highest point of the arch. This is known as crown or the apex of the arch. The height of the crown above the support level is called rise. So this is the height of the apex from the support levels or from the springing points. Okay. So this image is shown an arch. Okay. So here I am going to discuss the advantages of arch, or the arch is more economical compared to a simply supported beam of same span carrying the same load. So as we already know, a simply supported beam has a moment due to the support reactions and the loads that are acting on it. While coming to the arches, here you can see a horizontal thrust that is acting on the end supports, so that the horizontal thrust into the corresponding ordinate, that is, if we call the horizontal thrust as H and the corresponding ordinate as Y, then H into Y, so that amount of reduction will come in terms of bending moment. Okay, that's why it is called economical. Because of the curved nature of arches, they give rise to horizontal forces. So the abutments are designed for horizontal forces also. So any section in an arch will be subjected to normal thrust, radial shear, and bending moment. Okay, so here you can see a cutting section on the arch. Here you can see the bending moment, normal thrust, and the radial shear. Okay. However, the bending moment is considerably less. So compared to a beam of the same span, that is, a bending moment get reduced by an amount H into Y from the bending moment of the beam. So the loads get transferred partially by axial compression and partially by flexure. So the reduction in bending moment results in smaller sections of the arch compared to the section required for the beams to transfer the loads. Okay. Now, basically there are three types of arches depending upon the number of hinges. So based on the number of hinges, the arches are classified into three, that is, three hinged arches, and which is a determinate structure, then two hinged arches, and the fixed arch or hingeless arch. And these two are indeterminate structures. So here we can see the figures of three hinged arches, two hinged arches, and fixed arch or hingeless arch. Okay. So what is Eddy's theorem? It states that the bending moment at any point of an arch, say P, is proportional to the vertical intercept. So here the vertical intercept is PQ, that is between the theoretical arch. So this is a theoretical arch. Here you can see the thrust and the center line of the axial arch. So this is the axial arch here. It's a part of a parabola or a circle. So this is the center line of the parabolic arch. So this moment about this point is proportional to this PQ, or the vertical intercept between the axial arch and theoretical arch. Okay. Now we can see the pre-hinged arch. So it consists of two parts, AC and BC, hinged to each other at C. Here you can see AC and BC, which is hinged to at C. So A and B are the external hinges and C is the internal hinge. Okay. So the hinge C is provided at the crown of the arch. The horizontal distance between the lower hinges A and B is called span of the arch. So the distance between A and B is called span of the arch. Now, the hinges A and B may or may not be at the same level. So it can be at the same level or it can be in the different level. So the tendency of the external loads is to cause an increase in the span length. So since neither vertical nor horizontal movements are possible at the lower hinges, there are vertical and horizontal reaction components are developed at the hinges. That means at A and at B, there are horizontal reaction and vertical reaction is developed. Okay. When the ends A and B are in the same level, VA and VB can be determined as in the case of a simply supported beam that carrying the same load. Okay. Now, so the VA and VB can be determined by taking the moments, and the horizontal component of the reaction at either lower end is called horizontal thrust at the supports. If the load system applied is completely vertical, then the horizontal thrust at each of the support A and must be the same. Okay, since the portions AC and BC are hinged at C, the bending moment at C is equal to zero. Okay, so here we can use the conditions of equilibrium as sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, sigma ma or sigma mb equal to 0. That is, we already know these three conditions of equilibrium. And in addition to that, there is one condition of equilibrium, that is moment at the apex or the moment at the crown is equal to 0. So that is the additional equilibrium equation. So here we have four equilibrium equation and also four unknown. So it is statically a determinate structure. So a three hinged arch is a determinate one. So the types of three hinged arches are two types, that is circular and parabolic. So let's see about the circular arches first. So from the property of a circle, the radius r of the circular arch of span L and rise h may be found as L by 2 into L by 2. That is, this distance into this distance is equal to this distance into this distance. This is the property of the circle. So that is used here to calculate the radius r. That is, L by 2 into L by 2 is equal to h into 2r minus h. So that r is equal to L square by 8h plus h by 2. This equation is used for solving the problems. Okay. Now, taking the origin at the support A. So here we can take a section from the support A. So this is the distance x. So that the coordinates of any point D on the arch is given by. So let's consider a point D at a distance h from support A and at a distance y from this horizontal line. Okay, this horizontal line. So we are taking this point so that h is equal to L by 2 minus r sin theta. That is, this angle is theta and this angle is also theta. So sin theta is equal to opposite side divided by hypotenuse. So this h is nothing but the L by 2 distance minus this r sin theta. Okay. So that h is equal to L by 2 minus r sin theta. Then what about y? Y is nothing but r cos theta minus r minus h. By taking this cos theta is equal to this side divided by hypotenuse. And from that you got y is equal to h minus r into 1 minus cos theta. Okay. Now, coming to parabolic arches. So taking the springing points as the origin, the equation of parabola that we already know, that is y is equal to 4hs by l square into l minus x. So here you can see the parabolic arch, and a and b are the supports. Here we are considering the same point d at a distance h from the hinges or from the support or springing points, so that the equation of parabola at a distance h from horizontal line at a distance y from the base is y is equal to 4hs divided by l square into l minus h. Okay, then if we are considering the crown as origin, then the parabola parabolic equation is h square by y equal to a, that is a constant. So that's the equation of the parabola. So if the springing points are in the same level, then h is equal to l by 2 and y is equal to h. So substituting the values of x and y in this equation, you will get h square by y is equal to l square divided by 4h. So if the springing points are not in the same level, considering if h1 is the height of the apex from support A and h2 is the height of the apex from support B, and l1 is the horizontal distance between A and the crown C, and l2 is the horizontal distance between B and crown C. Now we already know h square by y equal to a constant, that is the equation for parabola. If you are taking the considering the distance from the crown, that is h by root y is a constant. So applying this equation to point A and point B, we have L1 by root H1 is equal to C. So rearranging this equation, we will get L1 plus L2 by root of H1 plus root of H2 is equal to C. And L2 divided by root H2 is equal to C, which implies L1 plus L2 by root of H1 plus root of H2 is equal to C. So from that, L1 by root H1 is equal to L divided by root of H1 plus root of H2. That is, L1 is equal to L into root H1 divided by root of H1 plus root of H2. And L2 is equal to L into root of H2 divided by root of H1 plus root of H2. So that's the same equation as in the case of cable, with ends are at the different levels. So which we already know from the previous module. The same equation appears in the case of cables. Okay. Now, the analysis of arches and conic figure. So here you can see that the horizontal thrust is in inward direction. In the case of cables, it is in the outward direction. Okay. Now, consider a segment AB in the arch. So we are cutting the arch, and let's take a section AB and let's analyze the section. Okay, at the end A, here you can see HA and BA are at it, and at the end B, here you can see the vertical shear that is acting here. And a normal shear, radial shear Q along the radius, and the normal thrust N is also acting. So H is the horizontal thrust, which is acting at an angle theta with N, and V is the vertical shear, and you can simply calculate from the loads and from the shear at the support. Okay, so let the normal to the section means an angle theta with the horizontal. So here you can see the normal to the section means an angle theta with the horizontal. Then N is equal to V sine theta plus H cos theta. Here you can see that V sine theta plus H cos theta, that is V sine theta and H cos theta, are in the direction of N. Okay, so that's why it is considered as positive. That is N means the normal thrust, that is equal to V sine theta plus H cos theta, by resolving the V and H. Okay. Similarly, the radial shear Q is equal to V cos theta minus H sine theta. Since V cos theta and H sine theta are in the opposite direction, and V cos theta in the direction similar to Q, that's why it is put positive. Okay. So V cos theta minus H sine theta is a radial shear. So you got the values of normal thrust and the radial shear. Okay, So moment at D can be obtained by considering all the forces including the reactions on any one part of the arch. So if you are considering a moment at a particular point D, we can calculate the forces including the reactions at any one point of the arch. So we can consider the sagging moment as taken as positive. That means the anti-clockwise moment in the right hand section of the B arch. Okay. Now, so these are the introduction part on the analysis of arches, that is circular arches and parabolic arches. So on the coming lectures, let's discuss the problems regarding the same. So hope this section is understood for all of you. Thank you for watching. Thank you.